Thanks be to God. Please be seated. I want to remind you before I begin the sermon that I've invited you all to have a loaf of bread or at least a piece of bread with you, and that is an important part of our sermon as we go forward. So I encourage you to go get that bread right now if you don't have it with you. We are going to break bread together as Jesus did with his disciples. I want to return to Psalm 23 with you, a psalm that you are used to requesting and hearing at memorial services, but is very much a song of the living, the saved, and the redeemed. The Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside still waters. He revives my soul and guides me along right pathways for God's name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of darkness, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff. They comfort me. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You've anointed my head with oil, and my cup, it's running over. Surely your goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is not a psalm for the dead about to go to heaven because they died. It is a psalm for the living. Many psalms are about people who are in trouble and are begging God to help them. This psalm is the voice of a lone, solitary person who is saying that God is helping him, her, right now. Speaking all alone, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. God leads me beside still waters. God makes me lie down in green pastures. And it's happening now, right now. And then it says, you spread a table before me in the presence of all who trouble me. You have anointed my head with oil. It has already happened. This is a song of joy. And the reason I want to focus on it today is this is what is known as Laetare Sunday, the fourth Sunday in Lent, when we are meant to sort of give up the sorrowful sitting in ashes and lamenting our sins and feel joy, rejoice. Not necessarily jumping around happy all the time, but turning to God in praise and remembering all that God has done for us and feeling lighthearted about that. I want you to notice that she starts by saying God is our shepherd and compares us to sheep who are being fed grass and being led beside still waters to drink from the stream and being led by God's rod. And she is speaking of God as in the third person. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. And then all of a sudden she turns and she says, oh heck, I'm just going to speak straight to you, God. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. I want you to remember a time when there was an abundance of food, when you were at a family gathering and somebody you loved and trusted who was always there for you laid a table before you. Picture that time, whether it's a birthday party, a Thanksgiving dinner, the average breakfast before school. Picture that time, all of you, every little kid out there, every teenager, every person in her 90s, picture that great meal. Now, what are the sounds in the room? What's the smell of the food and your uncle's cologne? What do you taste? What do you feel? The teak table in my mother's dining room. The coldness of the room that your grandfather wouldn't heat. The crackling fire in your farmhouse in Texas. Where are you? I'm going to describe to you one of many family meals in my grandmother's home. In my large Italian Catholic family, my cousins and I often gathered generations in homes where we could fit everybody. But in my nanny's house in South San Francisco, she could only fit part of our family. And all of her produce was from a garden in her neighbor's yard that her neighbor let her use and to grow vegetables. and she always made homemade pasta, ravioli, gnocchi, and an amazing sauce. And so our teeth would sink into soft pasta, which I used to be able to eat. A very salty tomato-based sauce with vegetables and meat in it. A salad, a green salad, with just the right amount of olive oil and vinegar and lots of salt again. And we would laugh a lot. And my nanny would sing in Italian to us. And so I remember that laughter. I remember the home being warm. And I remember the Bernat or the creme caramel that she almost always served for dessert. This is the kind of abundance that God lays before us now. This is the table that God spreads before us in the presence of those who trouble us. And I bring this up now because I know this is a time, especially when people are hunkering down all around the world, and especially now in California, when we are worried about our stocks of food and we're wondering whether there is abundance for us all. The panic that people experience that causes them to empty the food shelves and the personal hygiene shelves all around our grocery stores is a natural human reaction to anxiety and to feed our survival instinct. It's an instinct given to us by God to preserve us. And so it's perfectly normal. And yet our rational minds tell us that all the food production and all the paper production in this country and in the world is still happening. And so there is no shortage of food. And so to hear these verses today reminds us that we do not need to worry about getting food. If we are an elderly person who is staying home to remain safe, we know that there are church members we can call up who will go to stores and bring food to us. There are delivery services that will bring food to us. And most of us have plenty of food in our houses already to feed ourselves for quite a while. We are taken care of. And that is an important message to hear today. There is abundant water. God leads us beside this water to drink it. The other thing that's important to remember as we focus upon this psalm is that the psalmist starts with, God is my shepherd. Because one of the other things that's happening in our time and place is that some of the typical leaders that we look to, that we have access to, are now set far away from us. Children have been sent home from their teachers and are now resting or being homeschooled by parents who are at the same time being sent home by their employers and trying to do their job while giving their kids homework and entertainment. We can't go to the doctor unless we have an urgent need. And so we are set far away from doctors and nurses and other medical leaders in our lives. We are set far away from priests. I cannot visit you unless it's an end-of-life scenario, and we cannot see each other together in church. Many of you are separated from your parents or your children, the people that you lean upon to do things for you. We have a void of leadership in the traditional sense, the people that we normally go to, parents, priests, doctors, nurses, lawyers, teachers, we can't get to them unless it's an emergency. But we can always get to God. And in fact, more importantly, God has already gotten to us. If you are here, God is with you. In fact, I believe God is with everybody. And so I believe this is an opportunity for God to be our shepherd. Some of you are bewailing the fact that you won't even get to go to your hairstylists. I know, go gray, let it happen. It'll be fine. That is the message that God gives to Samuel when Samuel is bereft. The political situation has become unstable. He has to go find another king while Saul is still alive. And he thinks he knows what he's doing. And God keeps saying to him, don't try to find this leader yourself. I'm going to find him for you. You keep picking the wrong person. So Samuel starts with one brother. God says, nope. Samuel chooses another. God says, nope. And goes on and on and on. Until finally, Jesse and Samuel are like, what? The little kid out in the fields? And God says, go get him. Times like this, call for new kinds of leaders, identified in different ways. God is appointing new leaders, unlikely leaders in a new time. And beloved, this is what I want to say to you about leadership. God has appointed you. By virtue of your being a follower of Jesus, you are a leader. You are one called to proclaim the gospel from your laptop in your living room. You are the one called upon to pick up the church directory and call people and see how they are doing along with me and the church staff. You are the one who are called upon to use our Faith to Go materials to help your children stay close to God in this time. You are the one called upon to be their school teachers. People living alone, you've got this. We're not going to let you be alone. We will set up walking partners who stand 8 feet apart and take each other out on walks every day. And you can call your relatives and we'll teach you how to Zoom and we'll teach you how to FaceTime. You've got this. Doctors and nurses, our hearts go out to you as we know you continue to go to work and risk your lives. You've got this. People are sewing masks for you all around the world. We're gonna try to get you personal protective equipment. You've got this, and we've got your backs with prayer. God tells us all, I know you don't know what you're doing, but I am with you, and you are going to be fine. You can't trust all the leaders all the time. Any human leader will fail on their own, especially if they get stingy about leadership, especially if they have to be the all-knowing expert. And that is what's happening with the poor Pharisees in the gospel today. They're threatened by Jesus' leadership. They don't want him to be a leader in the temple. And so they do their best to shoot him down because they're feeling panicked. They're feeling stingy about leadership. But this is a time for all of us to step into leadership. You have probably noticed that we are doing our 8 and 8 daily worship every day on our Good Samaritan Episcopal Church page. That's 8 a.m. morning prayer and 8 p.m. compline. And we have several church leaders stepping forward to lead worship for us. This has always been the way of God's people. They worshiped alone, hiding in homes. And when the Book of Common Prayer was made, it was made with the understanding that sometimes Protestants had to hunker down and worship in caves and basements and hidden in their homes. And people led worship all the time. You can do it at home and you can do it online. So we are sad that our Zoom group worship experience that we were going to live stream to you on Facebook didn't quite work. And we hope to get that working next week. But we know you're out there and we know you'll be submitting your prayer requests. And now I want us to share a meal together. I want you to take your loaf of bread. Mine is encased in plastic so that my dog doesn't lunge at it during the sermon and eat it. Luna is sitting right here, my little acolyte. Let me show you Luna the acolyte. There, can you sit? No, where is my doggy? Okay, so take out a piece of bread, please. Looks like we had a network glitch and it's coming back. Taste your bread and eat of the goodness of God. I think I just came back. Eat your bread together and we are going to move into, we're going to skip the next song because I don't know it and poor Julie can't be on this with us anymore. And we're going to move to the Apostles' Creed.